Let's close so that those coming late can take the back seats. I'll ask that we put our mobile phones on the silent mode. Just to observe the phone, please. I request that we observe individual silent prayer, please. Amen. Amen. Welcome to our usual national press briefing that comes to you every week on Thursday at the Ministry of Information and Communication. As usual, today we'll begin with highlights of the week, and that will be followed by introduction of our speaker for today. And now for the update. Following a successful global summit on education aimed at championing the call for girls' education, His Excellency President Dr. Julius Maada Bio last Sunday held a meeting with a cross-section of heads of Sierra Leonean school associations in London. President Bio, while recognizing the good work being carried out by members of the Sierra Leonean Alumni Associations, implored them to consider doing even more for their schools and for the country. Nobody is going to build our country up for us except ourselves, President Bio re-emphasized. Sierra Leone's ambassador to the United Arab Emirates, UAE, on Tuesday this week, met with the Ministry of Human Resource and Emiratization to discuss matters relating to the welfare of Sierra Leonean employees in the UAE. Ambassador Rashid Cisse thanked his UAE counterpart for the audience given to his team, noting that the meeting was geared towards addressing some of the challenges faced by Sierra Leonean workers in the UAE, following the outcome of several engagements with Sierra Leoneans living in the UAE who are challenged by cataloged with a host of labor-related concerns. The meeting was climaxed by commitments on both sides to manage bilateral relations, build bridges between the two countries, and pledge their relentless efforts and readiness to work in harmonizing labor issues. An MOU was to be developed to official channels for collaboration between the two friendly countries. The Vice President, Dr. Mohamed Jude Chado, yesterday hosted the International Ministerial Committee on Sierra Leone Social Health Insurance Scheme to discuss issues of health insurance scheme in Sierra Leone. The Honorable Vice President, in his remarks, outlined the importance of SLESHI, stating that it is a vision of His Excellency President Julius Maada Bio to provide affordable health care to Sierra Leoneans, which he said is a huge step in the right direction. The Ministry of Youth Affairs, together with Reckless Development, with support from UNDP, this Monday launched over 1 billion Leone's recovery grant to support 100 youth-led businesses affected by COVID-19 in the Western area. The government of Sierra Leone, through the Ministry of Transport and Aviation, has on Monday welcomed Air Senegal to the shores of Sierra Leone on their inaugural flight operation to Freetown International Airport at Lungé. The operation of Air Senegal will foster trade between the two countries, broaden, deepen, and strengthen bilateral ties among the two countries. Sierra Leone has become the 48th member of the Media Freedom Coalition, the Minister of Information and Communications, Mohamed Rahman Souare, pledged to continue to strengthen safeguards to protect journalists and press freedom following the repeal of the criminal libel law. Following six inshore patrol vessels launched last year for community surveillance, Ministry of Fisheries and Marine Resources, with support from the World Bank, has commissioned two additional vessels at the Joint Maritime Committee to intensify monitoring of the country's territorial waters and to curb illegal, unreported and unregulated fishing in the country. A team of high-profile officials from the National Electoral Commission, led by Chief Electoral Commissioner and Chairman Mr. Mohamed Kenewi Kone, on Tuesday paid a visit to the Ministry of Information and Communications to update the minister on the upcoming validation conference on electoral reforms and to further solicit support for the involvement of the media, especially the National Public Service Broadcaster, the SLBC. And lastly, the Minister of Planning and Economic Development, Dr. Francis Kaikai, and other senior government officials assured the Social Affairs and Gender Commissioner of ECOWAS that President Julius Maada Bio and the new direction of government are committed to addressing human security and gender issues in the country. Minister Kaikai made this pledge during a high-level advocacy session on the implementation of ECOWAS International Humanitarian Law, the IHL, trafficking of persons, gender-based violence, child rights texts in the context of COVID-19 pandemic. A lot of updates this week, and I think I've not bored you with much of the information that says your government is really at work. And now to our subject of the day. It could be recalled that a delegation from the African Peer Review Mechanism, APRM, was established in 2003 by the African Union in the framework of the implementation of the New Partnership for Development, Africa's Development Network, in November last year, visited Sierra Leone on a targeted review mission. The delegation was led by Ambassador Enoji M. Lemunika, who congratulated His Excellency the President, Dr. Julius Maada Bio, on Sierra Leone's exemplary effort at managing COVID-19 after spending days in the country to review the nation's game in the fight against the coronavirus, especially around the achievements made, lessons learned, and challenges surmounted. As you are aware, the APRM is a tool for sharing experience, reinforcing best practice, identifying deficiencies, and assessing capacity building needs to foster policies, standards, and practices that led to political stability, high economic growth, sustainable development, and accelerated sub-regional and continental economic integration. Member countries within the APRM undertake self-monitoring in all aspects of their governance and socio-economic development. Since last year, several developments may have taken place, and to update us more on the APRM targeted review report for Sierra Leone, we have the Deputy Minister of Political and Public Affairs, Mr. Amara Kalon. You're welcome, sir.
Mr. Director of Communication, I think I ask that I stand on the existing protocols. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Members of the Fourth Estate. Today we are here again to offer you with the achievement in the roadmap that was designed way back in August 2020 between the government of Sierra Leone and the African peer review mechanism. We are in the president of the Republic of Sierra Leone when he attended the African Union meeting. There was a request for Sierra Leone to be part of the targeted review for 2021. And that was approved by the APRM Continental Office. And today we are here to abreast you about how far we have gone and where we are going with that request that was made at that meeting. So ladies and gentlemen, today we are going to talk about the launch of the targeted review on Sierra Leone's health governance and COVID-19 response report. The Director of Communication had laid the premise on what the APRM is, what they stand for, and what this report will contribute to in the agenda of Sierra Leone. As a form of introduction, let me also reaffirm why the APRM and why Sierra Leone in the APRM. The APRM was founded in 2023, and the essence for the APRM is for it to be able to champion good governance on the continent. This APRM was adopted, they call the African Peer Review Mechanism, was adopted by African Head of States as a systematic peer learning and self-assessment mechanism. Here, what we mean by peer review is the fact that we all know in Africa, we have set the NEPA, the new partnership for economic development. And it is from those documents that we have the PRSP. And the PRSP is a document that fits into the national development plan of every country. So what Africa is doing now is to see for ourselves as Africans, how we can look at ourselves and see how much we have achieved in terms of good governance. Rather than allowing other people from outside Africa to assess us, wherein their assessment is based on preconceived ideas, where their assessment is based on what platforms or what structures or what criteria they have set for themselves. And they want to use that as the platform to assess Africa. So as Africans, they thought it fit that they need to establish an institution that if look what Africa is doing in terms of governance, and the African head of state themselves will be able to peer review themselves. So for example, in this report, you will see that 3 months ago, the president of Sierra Leone presented the report to his peers, about 45 presidents of the African Union. They looked at the report, and Sierra Leone was praised, you know, as to how we are able to tackle the COVID-19, you know, amidst, you know, the kind of infrastructure we have in the health system. So what's the mandate of the APRM and the APRM? All what we are doing, all what the APRM is doing is to make sure that we have strong policies that come from Africans themselves to be able to project the development agenda of the individual countries. And as a voluntary self-monitoring instrument, the APRM fosters the adoption of policies. So we adopt the policies, standard and practice that led to political stability. Next. So for the APRM to be able to achieve its mandates, they normally carry 4 different reviews, but we are going to look at 2 reviews here because these are the ones that Sierra Leone have done already. In 2012, Sierra Leone undertook a base review, which we call the first generation review, which is the country review report in 2014. And that is one of the reviews that every country that has acceded to the APRM will have to go through. And also another structure that is used to also assess countries and peer reviews, the targeted review report, which we are about to discuss today. So basically, every country has to go through these reviews. You have to do a country review report. You have to do a targeted review report. Why a country review report? The APRM is set on 4 platforms for good governance. One is socio-economic governance. The second one is economic governance. The third one is corporate governance. And the fourth one is political governance. These are the 4 pillars on which all reviews, all country reviews are set. But for targeted review, it is left with the country itself to decide which type of review they want to undertake. So for Sierra Leone in 2020, we strongly believe that we have done well in the COVID-19 response. And ever in the history of Africa, no country has ever reviewed themselves in terms of their health governance and their response to pandemic. So Sierra Leone was the first country to take that huge responsibility to look at our health infrastructure, to look at our health governance, to look at our health architecture, and see what platform or what we did to be able to handle the COVID-19 pandemic in Sierra Leone. Move. So, the review are there for a focused governance assessment. As I said, this review gives you a clear indication of what the country is doing, what he has done, and what needs to be done in order to be able to effect good governance, you know, in the sector that is under review. Move. Now, in 2019, the APRN started implementing the targeted reviews. You know, so four countries in Africa opted for the first ever targeted review under the APRN, and Sierra Leone was one. But interestingly, as I said, Sierra Leone was the only country that opted for a health governance and COVID-19 response review. Some countries look at financial, so you look at the niche of your country that you know that's the way you want to go. So you know Sierra Leone, our priority is human capital development, and key to human capital development is the health sector. So Sierra Leone, we decided that we need to look at our health governance structure and also look at our response to COVID-19 so that we can see how much we can learn from it moving forward. So move. So in 2020, after the request was made, in 2020 in November, we have the team that came to Sierra Leone, led by Ambassador Inonji. So they came, they were here for 3 weeks. They went through every district, every chiefdom in this country. They talked with civil society organizations, they discussed with interest group, they discussed with institutions, ministry, departments, and agencies. They met with the media, and they met with every group that is important or relevant to the health governance and COVID-19 response in Sierra Leone. And just after the data collection, they met with the president and presented the initial report. And I think my director of communication made the direct, you know, input from that. And these were the words of Ambassador Nonji, that the president of Sierra Leone, His Excellency Retired Brigadier Julius Mada Bio, is a real gem in Africa. He's a real gem in Africa in terms of his political will to move governance, you know, in Africa. And fortunately, this report has been submitted to his peer. The president presented the report to his peer in April 2021. And interestingly, these were the words of the president of South Africa, because the president of South Africa, being that he's the chair of the AU, is also the chair of the APRN. He said, after another time, a passionate democratic leader has emerged in Africa who has passion for his people and willing to make sure that his people become part of the development agenda of Africa. Now, after the report, what do we need to do with that report? Part of the base document of the APRN, when you have a report like this with the recommendation, the last responsibility of the APRN is to look at the recommendations of the reports and develop a national plan of action. And that national plan of action details the recommendation, the challenges, the opportunities that are there, and what funding opportunities that are available for the country to be able to overcome, to implement the recommendations from the reports. So this national plan of action have already been developed by the APRN, and the next stage now is to see how this national plan of action can be integrated into the medium-term national development plan of Sierra Leone, which is, we all know, that's a document of Sierra Leone. And it's difficult for you to integrate another program, you know, into it, being that we are almost at the center or at the middle of its implementation. But that's what we signed for, and that's what we acceded for. So now the APRM has agreed with the president of Sierra Leone, the president and government of Sierra Leone, that it is time for us to integrate the National Plan of Action into the medium-term national development plan.
So between the 10th and the 11th of August 2021, we are going to have a high panel African Union team in Sierra Leone. In fact, the first six, the advanced panelists will be here today. On the 9th, we'll have the about 18 of them coming. And they'll be here for the harmonization of the National Plan of Action and the Medium-Term National Development Plan. Mm-hmm. After that, when for those 2 days, we are going to bring the best of technical people across the country from the institution that has to do with this report, from the Ministry of Health, from the COVID response team, from the Ministry of Planning and Economic Development, from the APRN team itself, and the Ministry of Political and Public Affairs is serving as the facilitator. Maybe somebody wants to ask, what's the Ministry of Public Affairs doing with health issue? You know, let me don't wait for that question again. If you look at the four pillars themselves, all of them are talking about governance. So you're talking about political and democratic governance, and one of the mandates of the Ministry of Political and Public Affairs is to deepen democracy. It's talking about economic governance. In democracy, if you want to have sustainable democracy, then you have to have a stable economy, and the democracy around the economy and around the economy itself has to be stable. You talk about corporate governance. We are in institutions, civil society organizations, interest groups, all other institutions gravitate towards a national identity or a national program that promotes good governance in the country. And we talk about socio-economic development. The whole issue about democratization is making sure that we improve the socio-economic, you know, architecture of the country. So as a ministry that popularizes government programs and policy, a ministry that deepens democracy, a ministry that promotes civic education, I think we are right place to look at, to be able to supervise the mandate of the APRN in Sierra Leone. So ladies and gentlemen, 10th and 11th will have this technical workshop, and it will be held at the Golden Tulip. Already invitations are out. As a result of the COVID-19 regulations, we are going to cushion, you know, the number of people that will be in attendance. So meaning we are going to have not more than 50 people in attendance. Already we have 22, 25 people from all of Africa coming in because they want to learn. They want to hear from Sierra Leone how they came about to be able to handle COVID-19, how we use the Ebola experience, the platform that we set for Ebola, how we are able to activate that platform to be able to have that response that position us as a country that did not sleep, you know, in a way that maybe we'll be talking about protest and other demonstration in this country as we are seeing in other African countries. After the harmonization of these two documents, on the 10th and the 11th, on the 12th of August, then the report will be formally launched by the Vice President at the Bintimani Conference Center. That's an open invitations are going out, and that I can assure you that the media will be fully represented. You will receive your invitation to, because we want to cover it. We have, in fact, as I'm talking to you now, I've just received a mail from the University of Delaware that they are on their way to attend this launch. I've also received another email from the University of Michigan that they want to attend this launch of this report also, because it's first of its kind in Africa. Next, we have the state resilience to shocks and disaster. I mentioned about four pillars under the APRN. But a study was done between 2015 and 2018 with the African Union biannual report. And that report shows that for every year, approximately 98 disasters do take place in Africa. Huge. 98 disasters, whether they are man-made disasters or they are natural disasters or they are health pandemics or you name it. Almost about, around, approximately 98 of them do occur in Africa. So, in its entirety, it clearly shows that Africa is a disaster-prone continent. The reason for that is clear. The reason for that we are all part of it. Man's activities on planet Earth, our own activities, ourselves, what we do in our homes, the way we trash our garbages, the way we build our houses, the way we interfere with the environment, the way we interfere with deforestation, the way we damage our marine, the water system, and all the rest of it. So as a result of this report, there was a need to come up with another pillar under the African peer review mechanism. And the reason why they feel that so much of this disaster happening in Africa is the fact that one is the lack of institutional capacity for member states, you know, to be able to respond to such disaster. Second is the lack of working coordinating mechanisms. So meaning in Africa, we are not coordinated around disasters and shocks. So meaning independently as countries, we operate in silos. So Sierra Leone, you take care of your own issue. Liberia, take care of your own. So there is no coordinated mechanism in Africa to be able to make sure that we handle these shocks and disasters as they occur across the country. Or how can we make sure that we forestall them or we stop them happening? So while assessing the depth and magnitude of shocks and disasters as one of the building blocks underpinning their work, key relevant institutions also recognize that member states should be capacitated. The capacity development for disaster reduction, risk reduction, had then been identified as one of the main ways of substantially reducing disaster losses in Africa. So in December 2019, because of this report, the European Union was able to approve funding for this pillar. And so, in 2021, Sierra Leone has been identified as the first country in Africa to host a capacity workshop, you know, a capacity workshop on state resilience to shocks and disaster. It's huge for Sierra Leone. For Sierra Leone at this point in time to be identified to host a workshop like this, meaning few weeks back, we are all crying that the UK has flagged Sierra Leone. We have a red flag for Sierra Leone. So for the African Union to choose Sierra Leone, wherein they'll be bringing all cabinet ministers under which ministries they have institution that has to deal with shocks and disasters, to come to Sierra Leone is really a blessing for this country. Smooth. So that's going to be on the 13th and 14th August 2021, and that's going to be a Golden Tulip move. So these are the objectives of the workshop. One is to strengthen national and subnational government capabilities in mainstreaming disaster risks into national development plans. The workshop also seeks to undertake a sensitization target at a wider constituency of state and non-state actors supportive of building political commitment for more meaningful and constructive public engagement in public engagement in public policy. Who are the participants? So one participant from each selected member state, from key ministries with a portfolio of disaster risk management from selected economic community of West Africa, that's ECOWAS, representative of ECOWAS member state, that all member states, ECOWAS member states who have embassies in Sierra Leone have been automatically invited to that workshop. A member of the technical working group on state resilience to shocks, so you have the African Union itself, the Department of Rural Economy and Agriculture will be here, the United Nations Office for Disaster Risk Regional Office for Africa is also going to be here, the World Health Organization African Region is going to be here, and finally, they have a strategic partnership within the APR, and they also are going to be here. The African Development Bank is going to be here, the United Nations Development Program is going to be here, the Mo Ibrahim Foundation is going to be here. The United Nations Economic Commission for Africa is also going to be here. So ladies and gentlemen, this is the three workshops we have starting from the 10th of August to the 14th. So meaning Sierra Leone is going to be fully engaged during those 4 days. And we're going to have about 90 to 95 delegates attending these three programs within these 4 days. And trust me that we'll make sure that we have the media to cover this from day one to the final day itself.
Thank you very much. Any question, I'm here to answer.
Thank you very much, the Deputy Minister of Political Affairs. Now, distinguished colleagues, you may have heard them from the Deputy Minister. In other words, it's a media advisory and alert to where Sierra Leone is moving towards. I normally take my time to send the alert so that we may do proper research about the subject matter and to ask relevant questions that we may need to inform our listening public out there. For those of us in the mass comm sector, professional journalists, we call that an agenda setting strategy with a view of taking you from the hyper and bringing you to related development issues across the continent, Sierra Leone being an exemplary. So on this note, I'll now throw the ball in your court to ask questions geared towards this achievement, the sustainability of such programs in the country, and how that will enhance our midterm development agenda in the country. So over to you for questions.
Minister Mohamed Kamara, Washington Speaker. I have three questions for you. Question one. Your speech reminds me of the days of the Cold War, when we have African nations, the Caribbean, and of course the Pacific Oceans, forming themselves to Virginia, not supportive of the Western arms, because it was a Cold War. Now, you're introducing APRN as an independent institution which does isolate itself from Western norms, Western domination, and should decide its own of African-made ideas, of no dependency, absolutely. But from what you've stated here, in terms of economic development, COVID-19 positive results, of which populations, you say, are emitted into radio, and many other factors, it seems to me that APM counties are not totally independent from Western nations, but rather are morally and financially still independent to develop their respective countries. Thank you. Could you tell us much more better? What best could African countries do to decide they are on their own without taking to the consideration any African support, any international support from the West, because we have our own mineral resources here to utilize, get money, and be on our own. But dependence on these nations, say the minister to be indebted to these nations. And thank you, sir. Can I go to the second question, sir?
Okay, well,
Mr. Ture, this is our forum. Please allow me.
I know. But I'm the moderator.
What is this opportunity, with due respect to you, sir, to get this minister, because I had a lot of questions to ask before. And the rivalry comes here. Yes, sir, Mr. Minister, you remember before the Mitchell Manning break, your ministry was as popular as any other ministry. In the homes, it was a ministry of both political and public affairs. In the streets, and on public transport, it was a ministry of public and public affairs. That was the time when the president of the government of President Pew appointed a national peace conference, of course. After that, to the best of my knowledge, everything died down. Could you tell us, as the mediating ministry between governments and society, how many complaints did you receive since we are appointed in that office, right, from the general public? Thank you.
Any other question from the floor? Thank you very much, my brother. I am the moderator and chairperson of this program. But sometimes your preamble instead takes more time than the question itself. So let's move straight to the question. If not from the soup, we set the preamble. All right, thank you.
Vincent Chavimowa, New Vision newspaper. I want to know why Sierra Leone opted for the head governance sector and public response. That's one. The other question, with these three workshops, what would be the benefit for our nation?
Okay, I see there are a lot of questions. Let's allow
the minister to take this first round while you think about more. I think my brother has asked two or three, and you've asked. So let's allow the minister to respond.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Yeah, it's coming.
Thank you very much. My dear uncle, very last uncle, elder brother. Thank you for that. Very important. I know you are able to, you are analytical and you are able to trace my initial presentation while I was, you know, exposing the dictate of the APR. And I think in my presentation, I did not mention that APRM was meant to isolate Africa. Rather, APRM was meant to be able to use African identity, African value, African norm, African development trajectory to reveal themselves as to whether they are doing good or not. How can somebody from America review Sierra Leone when America is not in the moon? Then somebody from the MIT is coming to peer review Sierra Leone with a preconceived idea, a man that is now thinking about going into the other planets. And Sierra Leone, we are still struggling to even have control over planet Earth. So how do you expect somebody like that to peer review you? So the best person to peer review you is the person with whom we are competing. And Africa, we are competing with ourselves. So we are not isolating ourselves from the rest of the world. But I think it's time the institution was set to look at what Africa have and how can we use that to build on our development trajectories. I think anyway, that is clear. Your next question, how can Africa be independent? Well, independence is a relative term to itself. It depends on where we want to take the discussion from. It depends from where you want to take the discussion from. So I think we can leave room for discussion like that. And I want, let me just inform you that the Minister of Political Affairs is now almost completing the setting up of a citizen portal that will be used as a platform for discussions like this. Because we want to open up the discussion point. All this violence, all these issues, demonstration and all the rest are serial. People don't have places where they can. I met five people waiting at my office to complain. The first group was Swazi dwellers. Swazi. At that time they were fighting amongst themselves as to who should be the chairperson, who should be the leadership. And up to this point it's uncountable. From political parties, between and within political parties, from institutions, from interest groups, from individuals themselves, cutting from land issues to conflict between crop growers and cattle rearers, you know, to the issue of household issues coming into the ministry, because they know and they strongly believe that we have that capacity now to handle. And what we have been doing is not to handle such, but to make sure that we tailor those issues to the appropriate institutions for action. And I can assure you that we have been able to settle so much. The interesting thing about the ministry is that we don't deal with tangible issues. So it's difficult to measure our output because we look at the mindset. We work on the mindset of Sierra Leoneans. We try to build character traits. We try to build an identity around ourselves as Sierra Leoneans. which is difficult to measure within a short period of time. So changes over mindset, changes over behavior cannot be measured in 2 years, cannot be measured in 3 years. It's a long period, and it has to do with the behavior of people. So as you see the behavior of people change, then you know that now we are getting the result we want. Does that make sense? Thank you very much. Why Sri Adun opted for the health governance review? We all know that in 2014 we have the Ebola pandemic in Sierra Leone, and our health infrastructure was completely overhauled. To a point we all know the stories, we know the figures, we still live with the pains. Our friends, loved ones that we lost during that period, people we know by name, people we know by face, people we have interacted with. Our health infrastructure was overwhelmed and overstretched. And when the COVID-19 struck, we decided that the same platform that was used to fight the Ebola and eradicate it from Sierra Leone need to be activated. And we activated it. And with a country, you know, that cannot boast of a good health system, that cannot boast of resources, was able to use themselves, position themselves, set their mindset to make sure that we are able to curb not only the attack of COVID-19, but its spillover effects on our daily lives. And that needs to be, we need to document that. That needs to be documented. If you go to Google, I have the American ambassador, the new American ambassador in my office, and we were discussing, and he was saying, well, Sierra Leone, you go to Google, there are a lot. I say, can you just punch Google? I gave him my laptop, and he punched Sierra Leone, just Sierra Leone. 99% of the pictures that popped up were so negative. Shanty houses, children begging in the street. Dump sites, our water catchment areas being destroyed. Yeah, you look at the report around Sierra Leone. All the 80% of the reports being generated for Sierra Leone are from external sources. They are not generated from within. We have not been able to tell our own story. We have not been able to package our own information and brand it for people to consume. We have not been able to archive our own information, our own data. Every data that we use to assess Sierra Leone is taken from somebody. And when you ask the question, what's the methodology? They won't tell you. Where's the sample frame? They won't tell you. What's the sample size? They won't tell you. Who are the people that you talk to? They won't tell you. So it is time Sierra Leone we start to tell our own story by collecting our own data, interpreting our own data, analyzing our own data, and putting out there for people to see. And when we did this one, the world now know that even without resources, even without the health structure, with the mindset, we can make change. And that was the change Sierra Leone did during this COVID-19. America has all the resources with a very structured health infrastructure. Their entire system was overwhelmed and collapsed because it's a matter of mindset. Yeah. So that's why we choose that topic. We want to document. We want to archive this story. What we did during the Ebola, what we did during the COVID-19 for generations yet unborn to read. The history about the world is nowhere to be found in the archives of Sierra Leone. The history of this war is nowhere to be found. I can tell you that when we were preparing for Bintimani 3, we went in to look for pictures for Bintimani 1 and Bintimani 2. There's none to be found. Okay. In the entire universe, there's not a single picture of Bintimani 1 and Bintimani 2. And that's why we decided to use AYV for Bintimani 3. And now every
videos and pictures is now archived in the cloud system of AYV. So at any time, generations yet unborn will have it. So that's the reason why we choose the health governance, because we want to document what Sierra Leone did for the Ebola, how we use that experience to fight the COVID-19. What are the opportunities for this report? With what we have done, now people are interested in Sierra Leone. People are interested in Sierra Leone to see how we can, yes, they knew we don't have the infrastructure, but they know we have the capacity humanly to fight. So now people will come to provide the weapons for us to fight. People will see the need, why they should not wait until our backs are broken with COVID-19. So how can they provide the vaccine? And I will tell you, the vaccines that are on their way to Sierra Leone were as a result of this report. This is real for this report. Thank you.
Thank you very much,
Deputy Minister here. I think this has provoked a lot of questions. Just by way of kudos from our online viewer. Bobo Bokali is saying, Sierra Leone under the new direction is always setting records, winning international accolades. Yeah. Of political will is never a surprise. Mada is an exceptional transformational leader in Africa. Okay, that's an accolade to the minister. Let me get more questions from members here.
Okay. Anusila is my name. I work for the main newspaper. Mr. Emmanuel, what is the government think on the just report launched by Bomali Human Rights Committee? Then two, what is happening with the Thursday item 13?
I like that.
Which is projected for in the national budget.
Yeah.
Mr. Minister, sir,
yeah.
Your role as an advocate during the days when you were on the black movement in the East has given an exalted popularity. I know. I was following the movement together with Suleiman Sultan Kamara. So, Mr. Minister, with all these ideas you got, how do you hope to continue this conference is waiting for to make civilian not go much more further?
Thank you. Come again.
With all this expertise you have in advocacy, what do you hope to contribute? Come to this summit for Sweden to go much more higher. Thank you.
Any other? All right. The question for Bombali Human Rights Committee, I have to preview that, and you know, as the technical director who advised the minister or my officials based on releases, there are appropriate bodies to take the necessary action and they will inform about comments on this. So I'll restrict or restrain myself not to comment on the issue as of now, whilst the technocrats in that aspect will take a decision which will be brought to you maybe in the subsequent press briefing. I've taken note of that. Second question about budget for item 14. That's, I'll say it's a generalized question. I don't know item 13 from where you're referring to, except you clarify with me. Are you talking about a press briefing?
Yeah.
Initially, I think I've asked members here that you have to exercise a little bit of restraint, notwithstanding because of budgetary allocations to the ministry come quarterly. And sometimes when this budget comes, it's already passing the time frame. But the motivation thereof we had was that we'll be assessing the quality of your reports, frequency, and all of that. And we know those that are attending, and I must assure you that I have a database of all press houses that are making sure to be here. So we change from food that you get on a daily basis, because some people we observe from, you know,
In journalism, you know, we have what we also call participatory observation. Yeah, and from that, the result I got, some people come just to eat the lunch and go back and not publish. Yeah. So we decided to transform that into something that you can have at the end of the day by way of motivation. Still, it's on course, and that has not been let down. But I'm still working on that. And when the resources are made available, you'll be surprised. You'll be surprised. So I still take myself to say, yes, it's our commitment to do it, but we are also, it's a procedure and a process to which you will get immediate response, I assure you. We're still thinking about that, okay? But notwithstanding, I know a lot of your colleagues might be listening out there, and this is why from the statistics that I've studied so far of the attendance, the number is dwindling. We can understand PR is never cheap, and that's my responsibility as head of information. If we want to market or sell our product, we must spend. And so this is what I'm working towards. But on the contrary, again, you have your watchdog role you play as an intermediary between citizens and the government. You should come also to the press briefing, devoid of any other thing, to get information that will enhance your work. Already we get extended an olive branch to say editors should pay you. So the way of me giving you food or either giving you this or that, they should take responsibility to tell you go get the updates from the national press briefing. It's an opportunity to meet with ministers, experts, to brief you the way of money. So on that note, I rest my case and hand you over again to the political affairs. They are politicians, they will tell you more on the APRM. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Yeah. I never knew. I never knew people are following me. This. I thought I was having a new kid in the block. Anyway, I think what I'm doing presently for this summit is responsibility delegated to me by my minister. And maybe I want to say thank you to him for providing me the space, both lateral and longitudinal, to be able to showcase myself, which I'm very much happy about. For now, my responsibility is to facilitate and supervise the entire planning process. Once it comes to the implementation, then my minister takes responsibility for that. So my job here is to facilitate the planning process to make sure that whatever needs to be done or whatever needs to be put in place, it's been put in place to make sure that we have 3 workshops that will again put the name of Sierra Leone above every other name. So that's what I'm doing here. And that has to do what I'm doing now.
Yeah.
Making sure that the message sits. It's not all about talking, but making people understand why all this report? Because if people don't understand it, they've lost interest. And I think it's time, all of us here, it's time we start asking ourselves, who are the people telling our own stories? Who are they talking to? Where are they analyzing this data? The peace index for Sierra Leone are this, the corruption index are this, the this are this. But see, all the time, if the report is good for Sierra Leone, we are okay, we go on radio, we talk good. But when the report is bad as well, we say, oh, no. But we have not been able to generate our own data based upon the indicator they are also using. And that's why we are looking at this now. And for the Ministry of Political and Public Affairs, I will assure you that we are now establishing a policy and research unit. We want to tell our own stories. Why the Ministry of Information and Communication is providing the regulatory framework around information and communication and providing us information on events and happenings. We want to look beyond just the events and happenings. How those events and happenings are touching the daily lives of Sierra Leoneans. How Sierra Leoneans are responding to those services being delivered to them. What space are we providing for them to make their feedbacks
feedbacks, not only during protests, as we saw in Jumbo, as we saw in Makini, but system wherein people can go and report, and they strongly believe that responses will come after. How do we make sure that young people become part of the decision making? If not vertical, but it can be horizontal. At your own community, how can you contribute to decision making? It's not about moving you from my village, Dankawadi in Palabar district, where my mother comes from, and bring you to Freetown. If you want to have a passport, you don't need to move from my village, my father's village as Kamadu, as Sukrala in Kwenadugu, to Freetown. You can be right at your palo and be able to know what you need to put together to get your passport in Freetown. That's what the ministry we want to do. Make service delivery easier so that we are assured of good governance. And all this shouting, all this noise, they will die down naturally. So I say thank you very much. That's what I'm doing as a ministry, and I enjoy doing it most.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much.
Honorable, I think I'm permitted to use honorable to whom it deserves, because only to put them in. However, I want to give you a tip of by way of media alert, though I'm coming out with a release later in the day. And before you go, let me just tell you, the work will not go in vain. All activities of the ministry will have a database of your names, and you will be treated as priorities within and without. So there is a lot of benefit apart from eating for item 2. Now, update. As you are aware, the World for Today is observed globally every year on the 19th of August. And this year, Segedin will join other nations around the world to observe World for Today. Photojournalism is part of our work. We know very well, though people who have not specialized in that area. So you have the opportunity also to listen to presentations on that day. And it's going to be in Potloko, right, on the 19th. And that will be at the Red Cross Hall in Potloko. So as part of your participation, though we're thinking about decentralization, that is, journalists in Potloko, who are your correspondents, you send reports, but we identify, for instance, by way of compensating your attendance to the press briefing to say, this man was always regular, let him be there, then that pandemic chop up. That's part of the work. So you're coming here, we're seeing you. That's why personally, some of you, I send press releases to you personally. That means I've recognized your work. What more do you want more than that? Now, the theme for this World Photography Day is going to be COVID-19 through the lens. So we want to encourage you to be part of it and to attend. And the objective of why we are celebrating this day is to showcase innovations and skills of the profession, and also to exhibit photo products based on this year's theme. Encourage and inspire and reward seasoned photographers for greater proficiency, professionalism, creativity, and technical ability. So that's what we are going to do, like Minister was saying. He indicted me somehow that they wanted information on so. This ministry is responsible for archiving all the records of audiovisual in the country. This has been a setback over the years. I'm trying to revamp this sector under this new direction. So in view of that, we recognize photography to be a very important thing. That's why we are collaborating this time with the Union of Sierra Leone Photographers. Next press briefing will be here to talk on that, and you can ask more questions about the future of photography and how that enhances journalism, your profession, and the stages of professionalism all will be presented here in terms of photography. On this note, let me thank you very much for your effort. God is seeing all of us, and he knows your endeavors, and he will make it fruitful for you. Thank you very much.